Well, hello again, buddy. This episode of the podcast is sponsored by 101 CBD, the makers of premium raw CBD oil products. Now, raw CBD or CBDA and regular CBD are different in a few different ways. One of them is that CBDA is more bioavailable, so the body can metabolize it with less effort and in less time. Another way is that CBDA isn't known to bind directly with the CB1 or CB2 receptors, but it interacts with the endocannabinoid system as an inhibitor to the COX-2 enzymes, giving CBDA the potential to reduce inflammatory activity throughout the body. You see, the COX-2 enzyme is associated with inflammation after we have an injury or an infection. So by blocking that enzyme, raw CBD or CBDA can relieve inflammation and the pain associated with that. So go over to 101cbd.org, pick yourself up some Alleviate sublingual raw CBD oil. It comes in a lot of great flavors. My favorite is the citrus and the blueberry. And while you're over there, take a look at some of their different CBD monthly subscription programs that they have. And don't forget that you can get 25% off of your order when you use coupon code IMGS25 at checkout. And now a quick word about Bud Buddy, your one-stop shop for curated cannabis products. Once again this week, they have an awesome bundle available for us. That is the Space Explorer Bundle number 2, which comes with the Galaxy Spoon Pipe, which is made by our friends over at Empire Glassworks. It also has the G-Pen Connect Vaporizer, which this is a really kind of a cool thing. It's like an electronic nail or banger for your dab rig. That way you don't have to use a torch. And also in that bundle is the Terp Slurper Quartz Banger Nail. So go over to budbuddyonline.com, put all three of these things in your shopping cart, and then you need to use discount code SpaceExplorerNumber2 to get 15% off of that bundle. All right, now let's start the show. Well, welcome back, brothers and sisters. This is the In My Grow Show, the podcast dedicated to taking the mystery out of cannabis. I'm your host, Alex, and I want to thank you, as always, for taking the time to listen to me. I truly do appreciate it. Now, later on in the show, I'm going to keep talking about soil amendments. Today, it's going to be just a quick note about insect frass, because I've also got my buddy Rodney Medina to come on the show and continue the conversation about tools and tricks that we can use to start a small business. But before all that, I want to talk about a couple of things. So this past week, I went over to a RIncon-Vitova insectary. You can find them at RIncon-Vitova.com. I went over there, picked up some green lacewing eggs because, you know what? As they told me, it is never too cold for aphids to be flying around in your garden. So, you know, went over there, picked up, I think it was like 3,000 green lacewing eggs. And it came out to like $20, really cheap. And their website's a great resource because in it, they have a couple of different guides. One of them, you can look up the pest that's in your garden and it'll tell you what natural predator will kill it. The other one will just, you know, talk about all the natural predators they have and what they end up feeding on. So if you get a chance, take some time, go over to RinconVitova.com and check it out. Now, they don't pay me to say that. I'm just a really big fan of everybody over there and what they do. You know, Ron's over there, Tyra, Gabe. Everybody over there is really cool, really knowledgeable people. So yeah, check it out. I mean, especially if you want natural predators in your garden. And now I want to take this moment to say Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers out there. I want to say Happy Mother's Day to my mother. Thank you very much, Mom, for everything you taught me, everything you showed me, and all the love you gave me. Appreciate it. I want to say Happy Mother's Day to my wife for just being the awesome mother that she is. And I want to thank all the other mothers out there for keeping it together, man, especially during the quarantine. It hasn't been easy. I know this. I see this. I understand this. So yeah, just a big thank you to all the moms out there. You ladies are killing it. Good job. All right, now let's do the strain of the week. And today I'm going to give it up to the Indica Spirit. All right, now the internet says it is a Peruvian Landrace lineage, hails from the Holy Mountains or Las Montañas Sagradas, where she has been known for thousands of years as a natural medicinal miracle, a gift from the protectors of the land. Now, I really like this flower, this indica. It was really awesome to smoke. You know, it was really a smooth high, really euphoric, and it was really great as one of those like all-day smokes from wake and bake to bedtime. You know, super consistent high, wasn't really an indica in the sense that it really, you know, zapped my motivation or made me sleepy. I didn't feel any of that, but it was really like uplifting and, you know, just a great high. It was really smooth. I really liked it. Totally surprised. This is definitely something I will look out for and get more of, man. So if you see the Indica Spirit out there, pick yourself up some. It's really nice. Now, I want to say a really quick word about growing cannabis plants outside. Because I know a few people who had plants already ready to go. Like, you know, they were pretty big plants, you know, 6 inches tall, about 3 or 4 nodes or 3 or 4 sets of leaves. And first day of spring came around and they put those plants outside. I also know some other people who, because we have mild winters here in California, the part that I live in, they put their seeds in the ground before spring started. And now that we're here in May, both of them, both the people who started their seeds early and the ones who threw their plants out like the first day of spring, they're wondering why their plants are starting to flower, why they've started to flower. You know, the photo period outside doesn't really start to change as far as like longer days than nights until around the first week of June, last week of May. So if you put your plants out early in the spring, or if you started your cannabis garden in late winter or early spring out here in California, so yeah, that's why your plants are starting to flower. It's because that change in daylight period really hasn't started for the plants yet. As I said, that doesn't really happen until around June 1st. So now you're probably wondering, you know, if you could put a light outside to take them back into veg just for a couple of hours before sunrise and after sunset. Yeah, you could. That would certainly help. One thing I would just let you know of as far as a pest issue is that extra light may help attract, especially in the evenings, may help attract moths. So just be careful. Just be aware. Just be on the lookout, I should say, because those moths like to lay eggs and those eggs eventually turn into caterpillars. All right, now let's do the report from the cannabis front line. And you know what I was wondering? And I even saw this kind of conversation piece come up on Instagram, is that since the majority of people are at home, they're quarantined, either because they're working remotely from home or they've lost their job, how many people are going to start growing cannabis? You know, because I remember back in like 08 when the Great Recession hit, the price of cannabis at that time dropped. And the reason for that was because some people who lost their jobs or some people who had more than one mortgage, they wound up turning those houses into grow houses because that's how they wound up paying their bills. And because of that, the market was just flooded with cannabis and the price of cannabis dropped. And if history is any kind of teacher, that same kind of price drop is going to happen again, if anything, more dramatically, I would think, because there's more people unemployed now than there were back then in 08. So yeah, that's a really interesting thing, you know, and I'm going to keep my eye on it because I really do think it's something that's going to happen. I do think the price of cannabis is going to fall. Okay, so I think black market prices are going to fall, and because of that, legal cannabis prices are going to fall. Now, on that note, I went over and looked up the cannabis benchmark wholesale market price assessments. And the chart that they have up there gives me what the price per pound is of cannabis as of May 1st. So it starts off, the U.S. spot index for a pound of cannabis was $1,334. And then the U.S. indoor index, I guess that's indoor weed, a pound of that was $1,706. And then the U.S. greenhouse index, pound of that was $1,139. And the U.S. indoor index was $849. $849 for a pound of indoor? Holy crap, that's cheap. All right, so then the U.S. medical, it is right now at $1,462, down from $100 from last month. Ooh. And then U.S. recreational adult use index, right now it is $1,283. Now, all of those are average prices in the legal market. So, yeah, man, all those numbers kind of surprised me and tripped me out. That's how much illegal weed is right now. So, like I was saying, I'm going to keep an eye on that, see what that changes from month to month or even week to week. Now, the next thing I want to do is read a little excerpt from the Schaefer Commission. So if you don't know what that is, back in 1972, President Nixon put together what was called the National Commission on Marijuana and Drug Abuse. And I think they were put together for like 3 years, and they did this whole really great in-depth look into marijuana in American society. And this was back in 72. And I just want to read a portion of it that I found super interesting. And this is just one small bit of the information that's in there. And this is in chapter 1 of the report, which is Marijuana and the Problem of Marijuana, under the subheading Symbolism. It starts off, a use of marijuana was and still is age-specific. It was youth-related at a time in American history when the adult society was alarmed by the implication of the youth movement, defiance of established order, the adoption of new lifestyles, the emergence of street people, campus unrest, drug use, communal living, protest politics, and even political radicalism. In an age characterized by the so-called generation gap, marijuana symbolized the cultural divide. For youths, marijuana became a convenient symbol of disaffection with traditional society, an allure which supplemented its recreational attraction. Smoking marijuana may have appealed to a large number of youths who opposed certain political trends, but who maintained faith in the American system as a whole. In a time when symbolic speech was often preferred to the literal form, marijuana was a convenient instrument for many protest. It was also an agent of group solidarity, as the widely publicized rock concert so well illustrated. I guess they're talking about Woodstock right there, because this is back in 72, that widely publicized rock concert. Alright. For the adult society, the decades of the 60s was a distressing time. The net effect of racial unrest, campus disruption, political assassination, economic woes, and the unpopular war was widespread uneasiness. Attending a general fear that the nation was witnessing its own disintegration was a desire to shore up our institutions and hold the line. The line was easy to define where drugs, particularly marijuana, was concerned. The use of drugs, including marijuana, is against the law. For many, marijuana symbolized disorder in a society frustrated by increasing lawlessness. Insistence on application of the law tended also to harden views, thereby escalating still further the use of marijuana as a symbolic issue. The social conflict underlining the drug's symbolic status has dissipated somewhat in the past few years, and in some ways the commission has similarly noted a particular deflation of the marijuana problem and the emotionalism surrounding it. We're hopeful that our attempt to clarify the scientific and normative dimension of marijuana use will further de-emphasize the problem's orientation and facilitate rational decision-making. So this was written back in 1972, and it was talking about how, like, middle America was having such a hard time with all the changes that were going on, you know, and that they needed really something to demonize to point at one of the things that's the root issue that's causing all the youth to think differently than their parents did, you know, to want change. You know, why would they want to burn down institutions or not even show up to certain institutions? You know, cannabis became a symbolism for that kind of hedonism almost, you know, for that kind of disassociating yourself from bigger society. And the older generation, man, couldn't handle that, or they didn't know how to handle it. You know, instead of trying to, you know, really listen to what was going on, they're like, oh, you know, let's put a cap on it and just totally arrest people for even possessing it. And the really crazy thing was that when Richard Nixon read the report, since it didn't go along with his whole story of the war on drugs, he didn't take any of these recommendations and basically hid and shelved this report. This is called the Schaefer Report. And there is a link in the show notes so you can read the whole report. It's a really interesting read. You've got the time, you might as well read it. And that, brothers and sisters, is the report from the Cannabis Frontline today. And now let's continue talking about soil amendments. And today I'm going to give you some quick notes about insect frass. Now, insect frass, which is basically just insect poop that is collected or harvested or farmed from insects that only eat plant material, that are herbivores or herbaceous. Herbaceous? Is that a word? Herbaceous? Herbaceous? Well, see, now it sounds like a funny word after I've said it so many times. Anyways, it is just insect poop from insects that only eat plants. Now, one of the reasons that it's so good for plants is that it has a lot of chitin in it, which is a naturally occurring molecule that's found in the shells of like crustaceans, lobsters, crabs, and it's also what makes up the exoskeletons of insects. And chitin helps trigger the plant's immune system. You know, it helps rev up those natural plant defenses to fight against different insects or nematodes that may attack the root system in the soil. Because one of the things that happens is that the plant senses the chitin in the soil and it thinks it's being attacked. So that's why that immune system just, you know, clicks into overdrive and just, you know, the cell walls get thicker, which means that the plants and the stalks and the stems are harder to chew through. And just like bat guano and worm castings, insect frass is a natural form of compost. Now, the NPK for insect frass is going to be about a 3-1-2. Now that NPK is going to be lower than like a bat guano or a worm casting. But, you know, insect frass is still a really great sustainable fertilizer. You know, and it's not a pesticide. It's not a fungicide. It won't harm or kill the beneficial insects or nematodes that are living in your soil. As I said, those are just a few quick notes about the benefits of insect frass. So don't be afraid to pick it up at your garden store, at your nursery, or, you know, at a hardware store. Check it out. See how it works for you. All right, now we're going to continue our conversation of starting a small business. And today we're going to talk about how to make your videos look more professional, look better. Because a really great way to help drive sales to your business page is to have some really great looking content. Because right now, video is everything, especially during the quarantine. You know, everyone's looking to make that more intimate contact with their customers, with their suppliers, with everyone. So Rodney was cool enough to come on the show and give us some advice. You know, give us a few websites and apps that he suggests we can use to make our content that much crisper. So I want you to hang tight for a little bit. I'm going to play some music, and then I'm going to put that on for you. So today, everybody, back on the show with me, I've got my buddy, Rodney Medina, because he's going to help give us, a few tips, a few tricks to help make our videos look a little cleaner, look a little more professional. Rodney, buddy, how you doing today, man? Thank you for taking the time to come on the show today, man.
Thank you, Alex. I'm doing fantastic. I hope you're doing well.
And I just, you know, again, I want to thank you for taking the time to talk to us, because this conversation really doesn't have a lot to do specifically with cannabis or hemp. You know, it's just about helping us, hopefully, you know, make our internet presence a little more crisp. You know, because if you're a small company, if you're going to start a small business, if you are a small brand and you're not doing some kind of video outreach for your customers, for your vendors, you're wasting a good quarantine.
Yeah, you know, in cannabis, there's always a story with people and how they got into the business. And I think that's a very good place to start when you're creating media or a brand or telling, is to tell your story of how you got into this business. When it comes to marketing, it always seems that in just traditional business, marketing for small businesses or startups, marketing always seems to take a backseat to everything else. You know, they get the products, they create the labels, whatever it is. But marketing always seems to be the child left in the backseat. But you really have to start thinking about marketing a lot earlier than you think you should, because that is what's going to sell your product. That is what's going to introduce your brand or your services to your potential clients. So in cannabis, it's the same thing. You know, cannabis is a new business. So there's new messages that need to be created, not just to introduce brands, but to introduce the concept of cannabis and how it can be helpful in your life. So there's almost two messages that have to be told. So it is really important that people in the cannabis industry, if you're starting a brand, for them to understand that your story is part of your marketing, is part of your brand. And I always suggest create media to tell that story.
Now, we were talking because I had questions about green screens. You know, right now, again, everyone's, you know, trying to find different ways to connect with an audience, to connect with that video audience. And you had some really great advice about, you know, just some basic things we need to remember about using green screens.
Yeah, you know, there are lots of methods of creating media. And one of the things that people use, like what you're suggesting, are green screens or even white backgrounds. in order that you can change the background of wherever you are. The green screen, anybody who's watched news, you always see the maps moving behind the weatherman. Well, they're shot on a green screen or a blue screen. It's called keying out or chroma keying. And what you do is you shoot against that green screen, and then in editing, you can replace that green with whatever background you like. So it gives you that ability to put yourself in a different place, or you can use support graphics or text behind you to support what message you're trying to convey. It just gives you a lot of flexibility. But with that flexibility also comes some things that you have to pay attention to when you're shooting with a green screen. If you do set up a green screen inside your little studio or even behind your desk, you have to make sure there's a little separation, 3, 4, 5 feet behind you, if preferably, so that green doesn't bleed onto you, because anything that's green is going to be replaced by whatever you're putting back there. So if the green is on your arm, then parts of your arm is going to be replaced as well. So have some separation. It has to be lit nice and evenly if possible. So, some lighting always helps. And of course you have to be lit. So there are some technical things that you have to pay attention to in order to get the full effects of green screen. And they can do that with white screen as well too. The new software that's out there, it actually gives you quite a few different options that of the background you can replace. White is more challenging because oftentimes you have white on, or part of your hair may be white or whatever, and now that would be replaced. That's why that green screen, it's such an awful bright green that we typically don't have anything like that in our closet that we're going to put on to wear. So that green will be replaced by any background. But it is a good tool to use for video makers.
And another thing that I've learned trying to use green screens is, folks, make sure it's pulled tight at the bottom, because any little breeze or a fan in the room is going to make that screen flap, and your your whole graphics is going to look kind of funky. I mean, unless that's the effect you're going for. Either way, pay attention to the tightness of it.
Yeah, that's true, and wrinkles as well. Although, again, like I said, the new software is very forgiving. It's gotten so good that I use Adobe Premiere, and the software has gotten so good. It's a little more forgiving than it used to be. So, good practices would be make sure that it's pulled tight, no wrinkles, evenly lit. And, if you're using whatever software you're using, do a little research on that software and what it requires or what you can do to make the adjustments to make up for those little flaws. And if you're not sure what you're doing, you can always find a YouTube video that will help you out with that software specifically. There's plenty of help out there. And there's plenty of people who are willing to share tips and tricks.
Yeah, YouTube is a huge resource, man. I don't think people use it enough. I know people use it a lot, but I don't think people use YouTube enough just to learn new things about things. Just to learn new skills.
When I started editing, I often what they call nonlinear editing or computer editing, I self-taught. I was self-taught on all those platforms: Final Cut, Final Cut Pro, the Avid systems. And then now Adobe Premiere. It was just getting in there and working things out. And this was before YouTube and before there was so much online help. Now it's a lot easier to learn things specifically for your software that you have, whether it's Adobe Premiere, After Effects, which does all of your animation and titling effects and photo montages and crazy things like that, and even Illustrator and Photoshop, which you would use for digital, creating posters, flyers, or even digital ads.
Now, let's talk a little bit about the importance of audio quality when you're making these videos, because you could have great video, nice crisp video, but if people can't hear you or it's really bad audio quality, people aren't sticking around very long to watch the whole thing.
Yeah, there's some number that used to be thrown around in television where I think it was 92%, somewhere around there. Let's say it was 90% of a presentation is audio. That's how important it is over the visuals, because if the visuals aren't there, you still have the audio to tell your story. So that's why audio is so important. I've seen some very good videos that people have made, but they're using the camera mic. So you hear this loud, echoey chamber style of audio, which it's annoying, number one, or you hear background noises. So if there's so many different types of microphones that you can use to bring that presence up, you know, put a lapel microphone on you, or now they have these a desktop USB microphones that you can just put right in front of you. And people are so used to seeing microphones now, it really isn't a big deal. So with audio, it's really important that you record something solid, so that you can use not only in your video presentation and now in this new, you know, when I talk about media and creating media, I like to be as efficient and as possible. And with all the different platforms, you have YouTube, Instagram, LinkedIn, Facebook, TikTok, all of these, and even podcasts like we're on today, you can make one video on YouTube. And if you have that nice looking picture and you have rich sounding audio, you can now extract that audio and make a podcast out of it. So now you're repurposing your content. You can make your YouTube long form video. You can shorten it up and make take 1 minute clips and put them on Instagram. And you can even take longer clips and use Instagram IGTV. So you can do, I think, up to 2 hours on Instagram IGTV. Then you have, of course, LinkedIn, Facebook, which you can do long form, TikTok, which are, I think, 60 seconds is the max on this. So you have to maximize your content. And when you start with good audio, you're able to take it across multiple platforms and really use your content effectively and efficiently. I call it the content vortex. You know, start with your long, it's almost like a vortex, like a tornado. The top part is your long form video, and then you just start narrowing it down to all the small little different types of content that you can make. It starts with good video, and even more importantly is your good recorded audio.
Yeah, some of the quickest feedback I've ever gotten on the show is from listeners when they tell me when the audio quality is bad. So just, you know, people are pretty quick to notice it, and people are really quick to tune it out, and more than likely won't come back.
There's remember the purpose of your all your media, all of your content is to, it's, you're creating a relationship with your audience, with your customers. You're creating trust. You're telling stories. So you don't want to be distracted from that. You have a really great voice, Alex. And you come, when you talk, you can hear, you hear all the nuances of who you are and your personality. So when you're doing that, when your audience can hear all those nuances, can hear the quality of your voice, it helps establish, it helps create and build that relationship. And that level of trust with your audience. So again, that's why audio is so important. You want them to hear your emotion. You want them to hear your all your ideas and who you are. So again, audio is important and will help that message come across, you know, more effectively.
And also, you guys, if you're solely waiting on, you know, getting the perfect mic to start launching those videos of whatever you want to teach people, don't do that. You can find some really okay quality lapel mics on Amazon for like $30, you know, and just work your way up from there. But don't wait for perfection to stop you from putting up those videos, from teaching something, from learning something. You know, invest in what you want to do. Invest in yourself, you know.
That's great advice. I think people do get a little intimidated by some of the great content that is out there. But remember, they started somewhere else at a much lower level. I've seen great content produced on iPhones or even other types of phones, but iPhones specifically. They shoot in 4K, so they're great cameras. So you're already going to have great imagery. And I'm talking to you right now on my headpiece, or just the standard iPhone headphone microphone. So I've seen great videos just with those two tools. Again, it comes down to the content. What are you doing? What are you saying? How often are you coming across? One of the challenges when you start creating high level content with cameras and other types of microphones and other recording devices and lighting is now you have to move that content from your digital device, whether it's your Sony A7III camera, to your editing software. Now you're taking all these steps, and there's now almost an excuse for you not to finish your content because you have to transfer it over, you got to edit it, you have to export it, you have to format it for the different platforms. Whereas if you shoot it on a phone, you're going to be able to turn that content around very quickly and be more efficient. And that is even more important than in some cases than creating good content. It's creating timely content. If you're going to talk about issues of the day or things that are going on in cannabis today or some legislation or some event that you were at yesterday and you want to post it today, the quicker you can get your content online, the better. Doing live videos is really important on Facebook, on Instagram, on Twitter allows live as well. So you have to have that good balance of pre-recorded, pre-planned content, and then be able to do some instantaneous content that will allow you to put it up online as quickly as possible. Because a lot of times that is more, being first or being quick is more important than being high quality. So you have to have that good balance. What's most important is that you want your customers, your clients, your audience to be able to rely on you to have pertinent and pertinent content that relates to them in a timely fashion. So use it all.
You know what? That's an important point to really kind of talk about, man. Is that you got to most brands, most information, it's all about the timeliness of it. You know, are you able, like you said, to quickly turn around that video into an actual post? Because it's one thing to have the video, yay, I've got it. It's another thing to actually be ready to show to people. And I've known a lot of content creators who hang on to video too long. You know, even though they just need to do a couple of things to get it out. As you said, man, the moment has passed. The conversation has gone by. That conversation's already been had. It's been talked about to death, whatever it is. And you've missed it. And now you've basically wasted a bunch of your time, man. You know, out of, I don't know if it was fear or maybe it was laziness. Fuck laziness. Get off your ass. Go put it together. Get it out there.
Right.
You're not doing
practice.
Anything. Practice. There
it's,
you go.
It's,
and there's
you
nothing
practice.
Wrong.
Get it out there. Get your phone up. Even if I've recorded stuff that has never seen the light of day. But it helped me formulate ideas. It helped me formulate a style. It helped me formulate a voice. Or, was I talking too loud, too soft? Was I, you know, and these are things that you have to see about yourself because you want to be able to control how you come across. In most cases, some people don't give a shit and they just talk. But you know, if you want to be compassionate about something, you want to make sure you're coming across as compassionate. I've seen some people create content. And they come off as angry, and that kind of turns me off because it makes it look like, oh, they think they know everything and they're talking down to me. And I'm sure they're not doing it on purpose, but it's just the way they come across. And I would want to know if I was coming across angry because I don't want to be looked at as somebody who thinks they know everything. I'm the last person to say, hey, I know everything about this topic. I've been in this business for so many years, but I'm constantly learning, and I learn from people who are younger than me because there's new stuff coming out. There's new software, there's new topics, there's new platforms, and social media is changing. You have to be really open. So practice your craft, practice how your delivery, so that you can count on yourself on how your what your performance is, so that it's doing the best job it can for your audience.
You know, and another thing I want to talk about as far as making that connection with the audience is you know, just watch the jargon that you're using on your videos. Watch the industry language you're using, because it's really easy for people in any industry, but, you know, especially in cannabis, we start using all these big words to describe things that really, you know, you could do it simply, because when we start using all this industry, you know, vocabulary, I mean, who are we really messaging to? Are we messaging to people who already know it? Or are we trying to bring along the conversation to people who don't know what it is?
Right.
Do you know what I mean? Yeah. Because I'm guilty of that too. I've caught myself just a whole ego trip in, oh, hey, look, I learned a new fucking big word. It's cultivar. Yeah, I'm gonna start, you know, but unless people who are listening know what the hell you're talking about, they're not gonna care, and they will tune you out again really quickly.
No, that's exactly true. And cannabis is a perfect example of that. You know, I've been a cannabis fan for many years, but it wasn't only until recently that I ventured into education in cannabis. So I'm learning as well. I don't know cannabis more than, put it this way, there's a lot of people, most people who are in the industry know more than I do. But I feel like I have to play the role of the patient or the person who knows nothing, so that if I were to use some sort of jargon, I need to explain it not only for them, but for myself as well, so that I can remind myself that what this is, and you have to be, you have to know who your audience is. So you're right. Don't use, you can introduce them to the jargon, but don't use it in a way that it makes it fly right over their head, because they will tune you out. So play that, what's the term they use, the skeptic. You know, play the skeptic. In infomercials, we used to have the expert and then the skeptic. The expert was the guy who used all the jargon, and then the skeptic would say, hey, wait, what do you mean by that? What does that mean? So they're playing the role of the customer, of the audience who's going to ask those questions. You have to play both roles. Ask the questions that your audience would ask, and be the expert at the same time, so that you can answer your, in a sense, answer yourself, so that your audience doesn't get lost.
Okay, so now let's get back to actually shooting content on our phones, you know, because we kind of touched on it a little bit about how just easy it is. I mean, yes, you can get all the gear out and try and go, you know, shoot video like man on the street with all this, you know, equipment.
Mm-hmm.
But again, now you've got to deal with all that equipment, not just on site, but then afterwards. Again, you said, you know, we got to pull it all off of one device, put it on another device, maybe another two devices. Are there some tools out there that help making content on our phones easier?
Yeah, there. You know, there. Everything is so compact nowadays. Even the professional gear is getting smaller. You know, when I started in television, cameras were huge, and now I have a little Sony A7 III, which, you know, I can basically fit everything in my backpack. And I do. When I travel, I take the small camera and even a camera light and even a tripod. The tripods are getting so small as well. But for phones, you can find, you know, I would suggest starting with even a desktop tripod, which are very small, very affordable. You can find them on Amazon. There's some with ring lights built into them. A ring light is basically a circle. It's a circle of light, an LED light that goes kind of around the camera and points to you so that it lights up your face and gives you some light, some sparkle in your eye, which is really important. I always use that as a rule of thumb. As long as people can see the sparkle in your eye, hey, then they can see the love coming across, right? And so a little tripod with a little ring light would be a great place to start. And then, of course, your affordable microphone that you can find.
And those ring lights right now, I'm sorry, I don't mean to cut you off, but those ring lights right now aren't that expensive.
No, not at all.
I've seen them on Amazon for like $30, man.
Yep, yeah, about $30. And there's kits that you can buy. If you just search, you can search for kits. I think they would say, you know, even social media creator kits, you know, you have to be creative with your search, and you'll find them out there. Well, it'll be the tripod, the ring light, and the little holder, which would be the device that would be the transfer between the tripod and your camera. You could probably get all of that for under $50, if that. So, and it's a good place to start, and once you get it, boom, just start creating content. You know, you any TikTok video you see, any TikTok user out there who's creating constant content is using at a bare minimum those tools right there.
Hey, dude, so are you on TikTok?
You know, I watch a lot of TikToks. I don't create any TikToks. I watch a lot of TikToks because there are a lot of very creative people on there. They're doing some incredible things with software that's in their phones. You know, they're editing software. But even beyond that, the creativity on TikTok is just incredible. And these are, it just made me have an appreciation for people out there who are finding time or finding their creative side and just delivering it to the world, which is really important. And also in TikTok, if anybody doesn't know what TikTok is, I don't imagine how you wouldn't at this point, pros and cons. TikTok is a platform where people make anywhere from 15 second, you can even make shorter videos, but 15 second to 60 second videos. And people do a lot of lip syncing, they do dancing, or they'll do editing about, you know, they'll do little edited pieces, they'll tell stories, whatever. But a lot of companies are starting to use TikTok as a branding device to get information out about their products. And sometimes it's cloaked as somebody making content, but they're really pitching products. You can also learn a lot on TikTok about different resources that are across the web. A lot of people are sharing those resources, how to come up with content ideas, how to do drop shipping if you're starting a drop shipping business, different website resources where you can learn how to write better emails or write better titles or headlines for your blogs. And they'll direct you to their YouTube channels where you can learn more. So they're selling their services, but at the same time, they're giving you a lot of free information that you can use already to help start you on your way to creating content.
And that's a good point, too, to make, is that if you have free content, nothing brings people to your brand, to your site, easier, quicker than free content, free good content.
Whatever you do, whatever your business is, whatever you've spent your time at in the last either 1 year, 5 years, 20 years, you're an expert. You know more about the topic of your business or your passion than most people. Don't be afraid to give away information of what you know. Be a teacher, be a mentor to those, because there are people who are going to know more than you, but there's way more people who don't know as much as you. And too many times people kind of hoard their hoard their information and their knowledge. You can't do that. Why are you hoarding it? You know, that is who you are. Give it away. Give it to people. It's a good cycle of business life. It's good karma, whatever you want to call it. Give it away, because they will never attain the level of information that you have, because you are constantly going to be learning. So be free with your content. Be a teacher. Be a mentor. Give it away. Give things of value away so that people can learn. And the reason being is, now if they ever need help, expert help or more beyond what they know, who are they going to go to? They're going to go to you, because that's who taught them. Again, you've established trust. You've created a relationship, and you are their mentor. So now whenever they need professional help and they're willing to drop some dollars for that help, they most likely will come to you. So give away your knowledge. People will appreciate it, and it really helps test you to see how much you know, and you'll feel better about it because you're sharing it with others.
Yeah, that's so true, man. That's so true. So now, did we already talk about this? Are there any like free tools for our phones that'll help us make crisper, more cleaner videos?
Yeah, you know, one of the things that keeps people from creating content is coming up with ideas. You know, what do I talk about? You know, what should I do? Within the realm of what I do, what kind of content should I create? Well, one of the great tools out there that I've seen online, which is free, there's a resource. It's called Answer the Public. If you go to answerthepublic.com, it's an online software. It's free. There's a paid version, but it's free. You can put a topic in there. Say your topic is false eyelashes, okay? You can put false eyelashes in the answerthepublic.com, and it will create sort of a schematic of all of the different topics that you can create just on that one topic. The who, what, where, when, and why. You know, are lashes safe? How do I clean them? How long will they last? It'll give you literally hundreds of topics of questions that it will ask, and then you just create topics on whatever those questions are. There's a website called Quora.com, and Quora is just a place where people pose questions. You can go and look for your topic and look at the questions that people are asking. Look and see how many times people are asking that question. Find what those frequently asked questions are and answer those. Now, somebody else might be answering those things out there on the web somewhere, but that's not you. So now it can be your turn to answer that question. Create content on that. HubSpot is another one, HubSpot.com. It's a blog. They have a blog topic generator. So find these resources that will help you create that content.
What was the last one? Hub what?
What's that? HubSpot. H-U-B as in boy, S-P-O-T.
Yeah, you know what? What you said right now, I think that's really important. Don't let a crowded field of people out there talking about a very broad subject discourage you from, you know, throwing your hat in the ring, man. What I'm talking about is don't be afraid. Like, again, let's take cannabis for example. Don't be afraid of answering this question a different way, your way. You know, again, like Rodney said, you know, somebody else may have answered it, but you haven't answered it with your perspective. Don't let that discourage you. Don't let things like that. If you want to start a vlog, a video blog, or a podcast on something, but, you know, someone's telling you, oh, there are so many podcasts out there. There's so many video logs out there about that. You know, why would you want to do that? Because, you know, you're not out there yet. You know, don't let that kind of thing discourage you from putting yourself out there.
Especially if you're a local business and you're marketing your content to your local city or your county or just your region, cannabis especially. I don't see enough cannabis content of companies who are trying to market their products to their region or their delivery area or the dispensary that they serve. Yeah, they're doing Instagram and they say, oh, come on in on Wednesdays and you can save money between 12 and 2, or you can buy this product. We have isolates and wait a minute, what isolate? What's an isolate? Well, it's this, you know, they extracted this. Well, wait, explain that. They're not explaining what an isolate is. They're not explaining what crumble is. They're not explaining what, this particular edible. If you were to educate your audience on these different products, they're more likely to ask for them when they come in. And then guess what? If you're selling other items that, you know, you in order to consume different isolates or crumble or whatever, guess what? You're going to have to buy some sort of device to do it. Then you sell them the device. So you're missing an opportunity to educate your audience, and which in a sense is hurting your business, because if they're just going to come in and buy the same thing all the time, well, that's cool. Glad to have them. But you always want to upsell them into other areas. And maybe there's another consumption method that would be more beneficial to them from a health standpoint. So you're really hurting your patients if you're not educating them on all of the things that you have to offer. And I really see a big hole in local cannabis companies and local brands not creating enough media to educate their patients. And I hope that changes, because otherwise you're not doing yourself you're not doing your patients the full service that you should be providing them.
All right, but I stopped you. You left off on HubSpot as far as like tools that
tools like that. There's tools out there that will help you be more effective and more efficient with your social media posts. There's another tool that I use. A lot of people use it. It's called Canva, C-A-N-V-A, canva.com. It's a free resource. Again, they have a paid level, but you can use the free resources. I've been using it for years, where it has stock photography that you can use at no charge. It has titling, different styles, or, you know, 2D, 3D type titling. But the best part about it is that it has all of your formats already inserted as templates in the platform. So if you're going to make a Facebook ad or a Facebook banner, a YouTube banner, an Instagram post, whatever format that you need, it's already inserted there. So now it's just a blank canvas. You already have the pre-formatted size, and you just fill it with your content. And you export it as a JPEG or a PNG, and now you can use it on your social media. And there's no branding on it. It doesn't say that it comes from Canva at all. Great resource. It's free. Many people use it, so that's something that everybody should be using. If you're creating videos, also with photos, there's a resource where you can get everybody, whatever you do, don't pull pictures off the internet and think that you can use them for your marketing. You can't. You're infringing on somebody's copyright. You can't just go to Google and download a picture and use it. You can, but you're going to get busted eventually, because somebody who takes it, anybody who took that picture, if it's owned by somebody, they can track you down. So
yeah, royalties will shut you down, man.
Yeah, they will. They will. I've had a client receive a $3,000 invoice for a small picture he had on his website that was only about 1 inch by 1 inch. And so, believe me, they will track you down. They have methods of doing it. But there's plenty of free resources. Here's a good one. Pixabay is a really good one. Pixabay, Pixabay. And all those pictures are free to use. And they're great pictures, great photographs. I use them on a lot of my social media for my clients. You can search through their volumes by topic. Even music, if you're going to shoot, if you're going to make a video of some kind, there's unminus.com, unminus.com, which has free music that you can use on your videos. Facebook Sound Collection is another one that you can use for Facebook. Sometimes, and YouTube. YouTube will require you to state that there's some, and this was always changing, but Facebook and YouTube will limit your ability to use particular songs if they're copyrighted, and they'll just kick your video out. Facebook does a lot of that as well. So
yeah, YouTube won't let you monetize your video if you have a copyrighted content on it.
You can put other music up, but I have a friend of mine whose son is a drummer. And he does a lot of he'll cover the drum portion of a song, and so he'll put these different types of rock band or rock songs, and he can't monetize them. He's not looking to monetize them. He's just looking to get his brand out and his talent out. But it will, you know, it basically states that you can't monetize it.
Yeah, that Facebook's not paying you for it. You're not making any money from Facebook.
So if you're producing anything that's going to promote your business, just be very aware of where you're pulling your resources from, your music and your photos. You know, Fiverr is another resource that a lot of people use. Say you need a voiceover, a very inexpensive voiceover for your video. You can go to Fiverr and Fiverr.com, and you can hire somebody. And there's plenty of talent there. For $5 to $10, you can get a nice voiceover done. They usually charge you per 30 seconds or something like that. But there's plenty of resources out there that are free and inexpensive. So if you think that's keeping you from, you know, if your excuse is that you can't afford it, there's a lot of ways to get around that.
Yeah, you're running out of excuses, man.
Right. Yeah.
You're running out of excuses. Fucking do it. Do it. Yeah. Everybody is like starving for content. Everyone's on their phones. Everyone's on their device. Why aren't they watching you?
Yeah, especially now that we're in this this quarantine mode. The internet is taking a beating right now. People are on their devices. They're on their tablets, their desktops, their phones. They're looking for things to watch. They're, you know, some people are looking for things to learn, and they're content starved.
Dude, the quarantine, it's made all of that really obvious. You know, that it's time for people to start just creating content, man.
Sure. And it's, if you're a brand or you're a business or you're, you, I mean, influencers are kind of disappearing right now because they can't go anywhere. So it's a level playing field right now. You should be using this time to build your brand, build your audience, formulate your content. You have 30 days. I mean, from today, we're still about another 30, if that. We might be 3 months out away from actually getting back to normal. But take this time to formulate your brand, build your audience. You know, go to Facebook groups that are relevant to your industry and ask the people questions within those groups. You know, what inquiries do they have about your industry? What do they want to know about that topic? What are they confused about? Answer those three questions and you have content. Start a poll on Instagram. Ask them what they want to learn about. And there you have more content. It just shows that you're being responsive directly to your potential audience, and they're going to appreciate that. Go to YouTube and search your industry keywords. See what popular videos are coming up and select content from there. A lot of times people are leaving questions in the comments area of the YouTube video that the YouTube maker never answers. Take those questions and make your own content on those questions. People always have those questions, and it's a good opportunity for you to borrow some of those questions on those topics and use them for your own audience.
Yeah, that's a really good idea. That's a really good idea. And you know what I was going to say is that the quarantine really has changed like the way we get our entertainment and how we entertain people. It's that just the way we, you know, get our content and how we make content for people. You know, the quarantine has completely changed how that works. You know, we're all looking for the new way of doing it, you know, of making contact with the audience.
Yeah, I see this quarantine as this whole what's going on with the worldwide pandemic as sort of an awakening for a lot of different things, socially, and in business as well. We're going to come out of this doing a lot of things differently, even just going to restaurants and your daily life, how you do medical appointments. Everything is changing. Appreciating the environment. I mean, look how beautiful the skies are. You can see the mountains and there's mountain ranges that are visible for the very first time in 30 or 40 years. I think people are going to appreciate that a little bit more and want to be able to conserve a little of that or save a little of that moving forward. But especially with marketing, it's really going to open up a new avenue or new opportunities for people, for content creators, and for people to know the what if this happens again? What if this happens again next year or in 5 years or 10 years? How are you going to react? You have to be able to pivot. Well, you have to be able to change with the time. You have to be able to make sure that your content continues to live, even though that this could get shut down again. There's no reason why your business should shut down. You know, I was on the phone with GoDaddy the other day. GoDaddy's a great host. They have service 24/7. So if you're starting a website, I'd suggest them. But I asked them how business was going, and what do you think they told me? They said, it's booming, man. It was a lot of people are starting their online businesses, and our volume is just incredible right now. Smart, you know, people want to shift to online. People who are going online are not out of business right now. Amazon increased their value. Jeff Bezos increased his net worth, I think, by $24 billion during this pandemic because people are ordering stuff online. Get your online business going. Even if you have a brick and mortar store, you have to give people the experience of what you have so that they know what to expect when they get there. Maybe next time it shuts down, you can just offer curbside purchasing because they already know what's in your store. They can drive up. It's packed for them. It's already paid for, and they drive away. I think that something like that is very feasible in the future and a good model to follow should this ever happen again.
Well, you know what? Two things on that, dude. I truly do believe that another quarantine is going to happen in the next 5 years, either worldwide again or regionally, like pockets of, I don't know, the COVID jumping up somewhere and just places. I think this way of doing business, of making contact with our audience is going to be it's going to be one of the realities going forward. And then I totally fucking spaced my second point because I didn't write it down. God bless America, bro. I need to smoke another point.
You're talking about the pandemic and how things are going to change in the future.
Yeah. Yeah. It'll fucking come back to me when we hang up, I'm sure, man, if I don't fucking get it together here. But, yeah, man. Anything else you want to talk about?
No, all I can, you know, as a parting statement is just to be educational with your content. You know, teach your clients or your customers and show them what you're an expert on and what you're doing. Be inspirational with your content. Talk about your journey, why you do what you do, and showcase the results that you've achieved for yourself and for other clients and your customers, and what it's meant for your life or their life and their business. Just share who you are. That's a good place to start, and be honest and be if you can be creative, great too, but sometimes honesty is just enough, and you'll come across as genuine, and people do want to hear from you. How many times do you go to a family function, or even you're around your friends and you hear them, they've hired somebody who does exactly what you do? You're a real estate agent and they just said, oh yeah, I just put my house on the market. And you're going, what the hell, man? Didn't you know I was a real estate agent? Well, I knew you kind of did real estate, but I wasn't sure. They forget, man. People forget. So you have to constantly be reminding them what you do. Be the expert, not only in your city, but even amongst your friends and your relatives, because I know somebody's out there listening that's happened to. They're a real estate agent. They hired somebody, one of their friends or family hired somebody else, and that's money that they could have kept within their circle of friends or their family. And hopefully you're good, and they didn't avoid you because you're a bad real estate agent. But it's you have to assume that nobody knows what you do. I like it whenever I walk into some place and they identify me by what I do. Hey, there's the cannabis guy, or hey, there's the website guy, or hey, there's the video guy. Fine, man. I'd rather them remember that than my name in most cases, because that's what they're going to hire me to do.
You'd rather have them remember that than not remember you
yeah,
at all.
Yeah, exactly.
Bro. That's the worst. When they're like, who are you again? You're like,
yeah,
fuck.
Yeah.
Need a better
and
message.
That's how, and you'll achieve that through content and creating content and putting that out in the world as to who you are.
Yeah, you know, one of the things I remembered I was going to say was that one of the positives about the quarantine that, you know, you really don't hear people talking about is that, you know, this really did forcibly train everyone to move their life online. Even older generations, they've had to learn to fucking order food online.
Yeah, just to survive.
You know, it's been this really interesting thing the way all at once be like, okay, now we're all going to learn collectively how to do this other thing. Because if it wasn't for the quarantine, dude, how long would it have been? How long would it have taken to bring people to certain new technologies?
No, that's true. A friend of mine just shared a story where her father, I think he's in his 70s, and he never finished elementary school. And because of this quarantine, he is now taking classes online that Harvard is putting out, and I think the courses he was taking was social or religious studies and whatever it was, but the man is going to go through this course from Harvard and come away with a certificate of completion from Harvard for this class he's taking. How awesome is that? The guy never finished elementary school, but that's where we are.
Wow.
Today the guy was, she had a picture of him. She was so proud of him to see her dad doing this.
Wow, dude,
and it was
amazing,
incredible.
Man. Yeah, I just think that's a real trip, dude. I think that's one of the things I was noticing. And you're really not hearing people talk about how this truly has changed it. Well, I mean, I don't want to say everyone because, fuck, I don't know. But a majority of people around the world, like how they do things, man. How they approach things, you know. Even older generation be like, okay, well, I was really hesitant about the computer, but now I've got no choice. Right on. Hey, Rodney, thank you again, brother, for taking the time to get on the phone with me do me a favor. Tell us all how to find you.
Well, you can find me on Facebook by my regular name, Rodney Medina. I also am on Instagram as Rodney Media. You can go to my website, themediaprofessionals.com. You can see some of my television production work. And that's really the best way to take a look at my work and see what I do. Be happy to hear from anybody, answer any questions. You can really see a little slice of my life in those areas and what I do. I've been working in this field for so long. I'm not really, I can't say I'm a specialist in any one thing in media. It's just media overall, and I enjoy it. It's my passion. And I'm glad to bring it to cannabis because I think cannabis needs so many different types of talent. And this is why I'm here now, is I'm just trying to be a messenger, help tell this story of cannabis, be part of this history, and do something good for humanity.
Right on, brother. Don't hang up. Everybody else, I'm going to play a little bit of music, and I'll be right back. Well, there you go, everyone. Those are just a few of the great tools that are out there to help make our video presence look a little more crisp, man, a little more professional. Once again, I want to thank my good friend Rodney Medina for coming on the show and giving us all this great advice. So go over and check out some of these free tools, you know, and make that video, you know, like we said, start practicing, you know, because it is the quickest way to get your message to an audience, to your audience. Now, don't forget, if you have any questions or comments about this episode, you can send an email to inmygrow@gmail.com, or you can find us on Cannabuzz, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook. That is @InMyGrowShow. You can go over to any of those spots and leave a question or a comment. Now, just a reminder, if this show has given you value, if it has educated you, entertained you, or even given you a little escape from your day, do us a favor and send a financial donation our way. You can go over to patreon.com/InMyGrow to leave a donation over there, or go over to InMyGrow.com, click on the Support the Show tab, you can buy a t-shirt. If you want to send that donation directly, you can use PayPal, that is InMyGrow@gmail.com. And another simple way to support the show is, before you go shopping on Amazon, click on the Amazon link at the top of the show notes in this episode, because that will let them know that we sent you. The show gets a commission, and it doesn't cost you anything. No, I'm totally aware that times are tough out there. I know there's a lot of uncertainty. If you can't support the show financially, do not worry about it. Here's how you can help, though. Subscribe to the podcast wherever you're listening to it. Leave a rating and a review. Subscribe to the website, InMyGrow.com. Then go over to YouTube, search for In My Grow Show with Alex, subscribe to the YouTube channel, and after you do all that subscribing, do one more thing. Just tell 3 other people about the show. That's it. Really simple. And I want to give a great big thank you to all the artists who let me use their music to put the show together today. And thank you once again for taking the time to listen to me. Now remember, I love you all very much, and always grow, learn, and teach. Double time.